Hi everyone and welcome back to this channel. Here's another video with exercises to practice with the Fourier transform. I'm Gio, I'm an assistant professor at UPF in Barcelona and I'm also an expert in wireless communications. On my channel I upload theory and tutorial classes on signals and systems, and this is the right channel for you if you want to learn the fundamentals of signals and systems rather quickly through theory and examples. So let's get started. Here's the first exercise for today. We need to determine the continuous time Fourier transform of certain signals by using known Fourier transform pairs. So let's start with A. We have a signal x of t, which is 1 between minus 2 and 2. Here is a representation of x of t. And to calculate the Fourier transform of the signal, we just recall that signals of this type, like rectangular signals, in general z of t is 1 between minus t1 and t1 and 0 elsewhere, have a Fourier transform z of j omega, which is a sinc function. And in particular, it's 2t1 sinc of omega t1 over pi. We know we can equivalently write this with a sine function as 2t1 sine of omega t1 over omega t1, right? So our case is a special case for t1 equal 2. Therefore, we can conclude that x of j omega, the Fourier transform, is 4 sinc of 2 omega over pi. So I'll just take note of that. And this is the representation. So the peak is at 4 for omega equals 0. And then there are several zeros that I can calculate, and they occur corresponding to omega equal half pi, pi, 3 half pi, etc. Okay? But what if I didn't recall that known Fourier transform pair? Well, I could have just calculated x to j omega by using the definition of the Fourier transform, which is the Fourier integral, by plugging in x of t. But by doing that, the integral becomes between minus 2 and 2. And by solving it, I obtain e to minus j 2 omega minus e to j 2 omega over minus j omega. And by simply manipulating this, I can conclude that the result is 2 sine of 2 omega over omega, which is exactly what I had found before, if I had remembered the known Fourier transform pair. That's great. So let's move on. Part B of the exercise gives us x of t defined as the product of two step functions, u of t plus 3 and u of t u of 3 minus t. So u of t plus 3 is non-zero when t is larger than minus 3. So here's a representation of the signal in green. On the other hand, u of 3 minus t is 1 when t is smaller than 3. So here's a representation in red. So the product of them will be 1 when both are 1. And here's a representation of x of t in blue. So what is the Fourier transform of this? Well, it's the same kind of signal as we saw in part A. It's just that t1 is 3 in this case, so I can simply conclude that the Fourier transform is a sinc function given by 6 sinc of 3 omega over pi, because in this case t1 is 3, right? Part C of the exercise gives us a signal that is composed by the sum of 3 deltas, okay, but they are located at different points. So the first one is, let's first calculate the Fourier transform of a simple delta center at zero, okay? So if I don't recall it, I can just calculate the integral, and I see that this integral is simply 1, right? So what about the other signal? So let's recall the property of shifting in time. So the Fourier transform of a signal that is shifted in time corresponds to the Fourier transform of the original signal multiplied by a complex exponential. So you see this at the bottom right. So the Fourier transform of x of t minus t0 is the Fourier transform of x of t, non-shifted, multiplied by e to minus j omega t0, right? So where t0 is the shift, it can be positive or negative. So by recalling this, I know that the Fourier transform of delta t plus 2, where a shift is applied, is going to be e to j omega 2 times 1, obviously, which was the Fourier transform of delta. The same thing can be done for the other shifted impulse. So of course the Fourier transform of 2 delta of t is 2, right, for linearity, and the Fourier transform of delta of t minus 2 is again 1, the Fourier transform of delta, multiplied by e to j omega 2. Minus 2. So we can now write the Fourier transform of the total signal, which is the sum of them because of linearity. So x of j omega is going to be 2 plus e to j omega 2 plus e to minus j omega 2. And I can further manipulate this by noticing that the two exponentials are cosine, so the result is 2 plus 2 cosine 2 omega, right? What if I want to represent the signal x of t and its Fourier transform? So the signal x of t is given by three impulses, as you can see on the right. One is centered at minus 2, the other one is centered at plus 2, and then one is centered at the origin, but it has amplitude double, right? And what about the Fourier transform? Well, the Fourier transform is given by 2 plus 2 cosine 2 omega, so it will go between 0 and 4 because of the vertical shift given by 2, and because the cosine has amplitude 2 itself, okay? So here's what it looks like at the bottom right. The next exercise has several points where we need to calculate inverse Fourier transforms of different functions, x of j omega. So let's get started. So in part A, x of j omega we're given is 1 over minus 0.1 plus j omega. So in order to calculate the inverse Fourier transform, let's recall that when we have a right-sided exponential signal, for example, e to minus at u of t for positive a, then the Fourier transform can be easily calculated through the definition, and it will be given in the end after all these algebraic manipulations by 1 over a plus j omega, okay, where a is positive. There's another case that we should recall, which is the one of a left side exponential. So if y of t, a certain signal, is given by e to bt u of minus t for positive b, so this is a left side exponential, well, then the Fourier transform can be again calculated through the definition, and through some manipulations, we come up with expression 1 over b minus j omega. Okay, so let's write these down at the top right, because they'll be useful for many of the exercises that we'll keep doing in this video, okay? So if we recall that, then we notice that we can write equivalently x of j omega as minus 1 over 0.1 minus j omega, okay, by redistributing the negative sign. And we notice that we fall in that case, in the second case, the 1 over left side exponential. So then it's easy for us to find out that the anti-transform x of t is simply minus e to 0.1 t u of minus t, right? So let's keep going with part B of the exercise. Now the x of j omega we're given is j omega over minus 0.4 plus j omega. So what is this? Well, I noticed that this can be decomposed into the product of three things. Well, j omega, a factor minus 1, and a term in the form 1 over 0.4 minus j omega. Why am I doing that? Well, because it's easy then to calculate the anti-transform. So x of t is going to be the anti-transform of this product. And I recall that a product by j omega in the frequency domain corresponds to a differentiation in the time domain. So the anti-transform of the term in the brackets is going to be given by minus the derivative of a simpler anti-transform, the one of the term 1 over 0.4 minus j omega. And I noticed that this is the same one as left side exponential, so I know how to anti-transform that. So what I obtain is this simple derivative. And if I just calculate it as the derivative of a product, which is derivative of the first term times the second term, plus first term derivative of the second term, well, again, I get this expression. And through the property of the impulse, I can further simplify it and get a final result, which is delta of t minus 0.4 e to 0.4 t u of minus t. Great, so let's keep going. Part C of the exercise gives us an x of j omega of this form, and again, I decompose it as a j omega times a certain term 1 over 2 plus j omega of the first order, which by now we know how to anti-transform very well. We have it at the top right in red, okay, times factor 1/2. So again, I anti-transform first the term in the middle, okay, and I know how to do that. I'm in the first case, the 1 over right side exponential, okay, so then I know that the transform is going to be e to minus 2t u of t, okay, a right side exponential. And then I know that because of the factor j omega and the factor 1/2, x of t is going to be given by 1/2 the derivative of this right-sided exponential. So if I just calculate it, in a very simple way, and I apply the property of the delta again. A signal multiplied by delta is given by the same delta times the value of the signal in correspondence of the delta. Then the final result is given as 1/2 delta of t minus e to minus 2t u of t. So next exercise has x of j omega given by 2 plus 2 cosine of omega. This can be written equivalently by using complex exponentials, and now it's going to be easier to anti-transform these. So the anti-transform of 2 is 2 delta of t, right? Because I know that the transform of the delta is 1. What about the anti-transform of the complex exponential? Well, I know, I saw in a previous exercise that multiplying by a complex exponential in frequency corresponds to a simple shift in the time domain. So in this case, the anti-transform is going to be given by delta of t plus 1. And very similarly for the other term, it's going to be given by delta of t minus 1. So if I just sum these up, my x of t is the sum of three impulses, as you see at the bottom. In part E, I have that x of j omega is the sum of two first order terms, 1 over 1 plus j omega minus 1 over 2 plus j omega, okay? So these terms are of the same kind. Right side exponentials will be their anti-transforms. So here is the result I obtained. So I get e to minus t u of t minus e to minus 2t u of t. So this was rather simple. I can just anti-transform them one by one because of linearity and then sum the results. Part F, x of j omega is again given by the sum of two first order terms, okay? 1 over 1 plus j omega plus 1 over minus 2 plus j omega. But this time I see that they are different. So the anti-transform of the first term is a right side exponential, okay? But in the second term I have a negative value, minus 2. So to anti-transform it, I write it as minus the anti-transform of 1 over 2 minus j omega. So now I fall in the second case on the top right in red. So again, it's going to be a left side exponential. And then, of course, x of t is going to be the sum of the anti-transforms. One anti-transform is e to minus t u of t. The other one is minus e to 2t u of minus t, right? So it's the sum of a right-sided exponential and a left-sided exponential. In part G, I have that x j omega is given by the sum of two impulses in the frequency domain centered at 100 pi and minus 100 pi. So how do I anti-transform this? So I recall that a shift in the frequency domains corresponds to a multiplication in the time domain. And in particular, if x j omega is the transform of x of t, then x of j omega minus omega 0 is going to be the transform of x of t times e to j omega 0 t. So I wrote this at the bottom right in red just to recall it. So first of all, let's see what's the anti-transform of delta of omega, although we might recall what it is. If I just use the definition of the anti-transform and I calculate the integral, I see that the result is very simple, and it's 1 over 2 pi, as you see here. So what about the anti-transform of a shifted version of the delta? Well, it's going to be 1 over 2 pi times a complex exponential. So because the shift is 100 pi, then the complex exponential that multiplies is e to j 100 pi t. And very similarly for the other shift in frequency, which has an opposite sign, the anti-transform is going to be 1 over 2 pi e to minus j 100 pi t. So if I just put this together, then I get the final result for my x of t, which is j over 2 pi e to j 100 pi t minus e to minus j 100 pi t. Okay, I can further manipulate this by dividing and multiplying by 2j to obtain a sine expression. So I can write this in a more compact way as minus 1 over pi sine of 100 pi t. Part H, finally, x j omega now is given by the sum of three impulses in the frequency domain again. So again, I recall the property at the bottom, right? And I also recall that the anti-transform of delta of omega is 1 over 2 pi, as we just found. So x of t is going to be given by the sum of the three anti-transforms because of linearity. The first one is 2 because it's 4 pi times 1 over 2 pi, so it's simply 2. The second one, which I marked in red, is e to j 10 pi t, because there's a shift of the delta that has an amount 10 pi. And the third one, which I marked in blue, well, similar, just the opposite sign in the exponential, so e to minus j 10 pi t. Okay, so that is my x of t, which I can write in a more compact way again by looking at the sum of exponentials as 2 plus 2 cosine of 10 pi t. So in this video, we practiced the Fourier transform with more exercises. I recommend watching the other exercise videos as well as my theory classes to better understand the fundamentals of signals and systems. And I'll keep uploading more videos on this important topic, so subscribe to the channel and you'll be the first one to know when I upload a new video. See you in the next class.